Howdy friends, welcome to Amygdala Vids. Now we all know why it's useful to be useful, so to speak. I mean, it's pretty common knowledge that the ability and knowledge to act can open up new opportunities in life, and could lead to a more active role in this whole existential game we're playing. But if we entertain the question not of how must one think about something, but the how might one think about something, the question could arise, what is the value of uselessness? What is the value of not being valuable, so to speak? Seems like one of those paradoxical and absurd questions. But hey, we're gonna answer it, because I need to feel better about how useless I was of a basketball player back in elementary school. So the philosophy of Taoism is gonna help us answer this question, specifically a story coming from chapter 4 of the great Taoist book, The Zhuangzi, written by none other than Zhuangzi. So sit back, relax, grab yourself a Tsingtao, maybe some Cracker Jacks, and let your pal Amy tell the story. Carpenter Shi traveled to Qi and arrived in Twisted Axle. There he saw an oak serving as an earth god shrine. Its canopy could cover several thousand oxen, and it had a circumference of 100 spans. Towering over the hillside, its lowest branches started at about 80 feet, several tens of them so huge they could easily be made into boats. Sightseers flocked to it as if it were a popular market. The carpenter ignored it, pursuing his path without stopping. However, his assistant observed it with admiration, then ran up to catch up with his master. He said, "Ever since I picked up my axe and chisel and became your disciple, I have never seen timber so beautiful as this. Now you don't even look at it, but pass by it without stopping. Why?" "Off with you," Shi replied. "Don't even think about it. It's a disintegrating tree. Make it into a boat, it sinks. Make it into a coffin or chest, it rots. Make it into a table, it collapses. Make it into a door, it leaks sap. Make it into a pillar, it's riddled with insects. This is not a timber tree. There's nothing it can be used for. That's why it could reach such a great age." On his return journey, Carpenter Shi again passed through the town. The Earth God Tree appeared to him in a dream and said, "What can you possibly compare me to? You want to compare me to a cultivated tree? Let's look at them. Cherry, pear, orange, grapefruit, and all of those other fruit trees. As soon as their fruits are ripe, they are knocked down and thrown into the dirt. Their big limbs are broken, their small branches torn. Thus they suffer through life and do not complete their heaven-given years, dying prematurely in mid-stride, yet constantly ready to receive more abuse from the world. The same holds true for all things. For the longest time, I tried to find out if there wasn't something I could possibly be used for. I almost died in the process, but now I realize that this very uselessness has been my greatest use. Just assume I had had some use for people. How could I ever have grown so huge?" Hope you enjoyed that. So I want to split the interpretation into two parts, one of abuse and the other of reputation anxiety. Let's start by talking about abuse. So the tree talks about how other trees that are useful, vis-a-vis their fruit, are knocked down and used for their usefulness. The useless tree was only able to survive because it had nothing to offer people. Therefore, it was free from abuse. Now how does this apply to us mere humans? Well, we recognize the power of being useful to other people and having something of value to them. I mean, hopefully you find these videos useful or else I'd be out of the job. Subscribe, by the way. But even though we can recognize the obvious benefits of being useful, there are downsides, especially in the form of abuse. When we have something that others want, sometimes those people may try and get it from us in less than ethical ways. You know what makes a good example? Those famous musicians or actors or whatnot. Sure, they live the life and get lots of money, but they also deal with people trying to take advantage of them. The higher-ups in the movie or music biz, so to speak. There's this one show here in America called Dance Moms where these middle-aged moms shill their children out for this TV show, and I wonder about the weird relationship that might be for the family. Like, the parents are kinda like their kids' agents or something? Kinda weird. And this doesn't only apply to rich and famous people. I mean, do you have something or a certain skill that people try to take advantage of? When I was a kid, there was this other kid who would only hang out with me because I had Godzilla Unleashed for the PlayStation 2. Yeah, that's my example. screw you, it's a dope game. So now I want to jump to the reputation anxiety point about uselessness. And I didn't specifically get this from the passage, but I still think it's pertinent to the conversation on uselessness. So picture two people, person A and person B. Person A is seen as smart, a very bright person, while person B is seen as dumb, for lack of a better word. Now the two of them are about to debate in front of other people. Who has the most to lose? Who has the most to gain? Person A has a reputation to uphold and an expectation to fulfill. This might cause a bit of anxiety as a result. On the flip side, person B doesn't have that reputation anxiety to deal with. They could only really gain in this regard. A lot of people strive after being perceived as smart, being the person that you could turn to in need of some info on a specific subject. But this desire to be perceived as smart is not the same as being smart. It's simply a concern with the opinion of others. And when you start playing that game, it might feel good to be told that you're smart, but you'll eventually find yourself in moments where you do or say something not perceived as smart, thus resulting in negative emotions. Why play the game altogether? Why strive to appear smart or appear useful? Well, that about wraps it up on my end. Do me a favor and hit the subscribe button, the thumbs up button, and the notification bell. It's the holy trinity of the YouTube algorithm, and it really helps out the channel. I promise more content coming soon, and I wish you all a very happy new year.